So welcome, everybody, to the Martin E. Segal Theater Center here at the Graduate Center CUNY. My name is Frank Henschke, and I'm the Executive Director and Director of Programs here at this center. It is a true honor for us to host as a season opener in the beginning of the spring program, and luckily we have a spring day, actually, today. It's wonderful to really welcome Takeshi Kawamura from Japan. Takeshi is one of the significant, really important contemporary Japanese playwrights, and he actually did come here to New York for this evening to share his work with you, and of course also with John Jesurun. Besides the fact that John Jesurun, who is over there, who will direct, he directed the play, is a great, great New York auteur du théâtre, as you know, with his own work as a writer, a director, and also a filmmaker. They are both collaborating on a new piece that bridges Tokyo and New York. I would like to thank very much my colleague, Peter Eckersall, who is my new faculty member also here at the Graduate Center CUNY, taking the chair that Daniel Gerald had, and his specialty is Asian theater and dramaturgy, and contemporary dramaturgy especially, and it was a great, addition to us, and things like today, it just also happened because Peter made the connection. We had a sensational afternoon, a concert, a true world-class presentation of Japanese chamber music, so whoever was here, you were truly lucky and fortunate to be able to be here. And again, thank you so much. It's been translated, the play, by Philip Flavin, who also was one of the players in the afternoon, and in the music ensemble. If you have a cell phone, I'll do the same. Now is the time to take it out and make sure sound is off. So please do that. The reading should last about an hour, 15, hour, 20 minutes. Afterwards, we have a little panel discussion. There will be a reception in this room afterwards in case you have additional questions or you couldn't ask your questions. Again, it's a great honor for us, and we are thrilled to open our spring season with this truly significant event. We bridge academia and professional theater, international and American theater. So an evening like tonight is right at the center and in the heart of what we do, what our mission is, and what we aspire to do. So again, thank you so much, Peter.
Thank you, everyone, and welcome to the Graduate Center. It's so wonderful to see so many people here to hear a reading, the New York premiere reading, in fact, the premiere of the English version of Kawamura's play 4. So it's quite a significant historical occasion, translated by Philip Flavin and directed by John Jesurun. Kawamura-san is a very significant playwright and director in Japan. He began his career in the early 1980s, founded a company called Daisan Erotica, which was very prominent in Japan and known, I think, in Western countries as well over the next 20 years in 1980s, 1990s. At the turn of the century, Kawamura began a new phase of his career as a writer-director running a small production unit called Tea Factory, and that's the way that he works now, writing plays, directing those plays, working on very interesting collaboration projects with other significant artists in Japan, working on small ensemble experimental pieces, and then also working across cultures, particularly with this very important connection with John that I think is an emerging project that is going to run over the next couple of years, which we very much look at with interest. The play 4 was written 2 years ago in Japan. It received very significant attention there. It's a play that I think typifies Kawamura's interest in contemporary society. It typifies his interest, I think, in place. You know, it's very much about being in a place and being alive in a certain time, a time where there are many perils but also many possibilities. Kawamura's plays are rich in drama and humour, and I hope that you'll see some of the humour as well as the drama tonight. So Without further ado, I think we'll just hear the reading and then have a talk afterwards, and Kawamura will be available to answer any questions. So thank you very much again.
Scene one. There is a black box on stage. Each man inserts his hand into the box and withdraws something resembling a scrap of paper. Each unfolds his piece of paper and reads it. One man exits, four men remain. Scene two. The four men move to their respective positions in silence.
On the way home, I stepped on a ginkgo leaf. When I looked up to see where it had fallen from, it was a clear autumn day. There wasn't a ginkgo tree in sight. Everybody at home would be waiting for me. I dare say the unchanging tranquility of home would also be waiting. I like to get home early, but I'm pretty sure the ginkgo leaf is stuck to the sole of my shoe. I can feel it. The sensation of a leaf stuck to the bottom of my shoe is novel. I had had the premonition that one day I would experience things like this, and now the former premonition is somehow a nostalgic memory. But I don't want to leave this memory as it is. It has come from a foreseen future, and it is a nostalgic horror. I gave up on the idea of returning directly home. I imagine everyone there will be worried. After all, over the last few years, ever since the birth of our child, I have never once stopped anywhere on the way home. I entered the pub near the station and sat at the counter. I sat in the seat I always used to sit. Nothing has changed. The menu was the same. The owner was the same. "Hey, it's been a while since I last saw you," said the owner as he greeted me with a smile. I was confused because I thought I was the only one that had changed. But even my order didn't change. A draft beer, skewered spring onions with chicken, and skewered liver. It somehow felt very strange. I can't be troubled with the regrets. It is a citizen's obligation, and somebody has to do it. There's no need to boast about it or call attention to it, but neither is there any reason to be ashamed of it and walk with one's eyes averted. We had exhausted all possible debate. I was the only one who fought against the many persuasive arguments. I felt as if I was superimposed with a hero from an old American film. This is narcissism. I even accepted requests for television interviews and did so without my face being blocked. I believed that I had done the right thing. I wanted to display the bitterness I experienced in making this decision to the public. Perhaps this is heroism? I should stop with masochism. I didn't ask for any of this. This is something that fell into my lap of its own accord from a completely unrelated world. The beer was working its way into my body. He's going to die sooner or later. I was the only one who was against it. The underlying reason for my being against it was that he was unemployed. My father was unemployed. And in my second year of high school, the company my father managed went bankrupt. My father had no reason to make any efforts to rebuild the company. Neither did he have any reason to look for a new job. That is not to say that he was in shock or somewhat dumbfounded. He was indifferent. Now that I think of it, he lived in a vacuum. When I first actually saw him in the courthouse, he was indifferent, and I recalled my father. This behavior was a drawback and clearly worked against him with the sentencing, as it appeared he felt no remorse. He was living in a vacuum, and this kept me from thinking he was a bad person. I was always looking at him, but he was unaware of my gaze. Not once did he realize I was staring at him. If I should have one regret, it would be this. I wanted him to know that there was one person in the room with these thoughts as they looked at him. This is unmistakably more sentimentalism. Nevertheless, a courthouse, this realm in which the slightest hint of any emotion is completely forbidden, is actually roiling with a wide spectrum of human emotions. The word remorse is not part of logic or ethics, it's an emotion. That which determines whether this remorse is true or false is also an emotion. The law does not pass judgment. Our emotions do. My beer mug was empty. I ordered sake at room temperature. I'm on a roll here. I'm truly on a roll here. My former self, what I once was, is coming back. Slowly but surely. Good. Let's look at these emotions that popped out all at once. Let's also get some more to eat. Stewed bean tendons, narcissism. Quail eggs, heroism. Skewed green peppers, sentimentalism. That and, would it be too much? Nah, let's have another order of masochism. And then one more plate of sadism. Hang on a second. Sadism? Are you trying to draw a connection between sadism and the death sentence? The righteous ones who punish the evil are bored with heroism as their father and sadism as their mother. Yes, I was righteous. I acted the righteous role in court. I became whatever it was I was pretending to be. And now I have severed all ties with the past. It's stunning to what degree I have become nothing. I have a house in the suburbs, and I am a quibbling, fussy university employee. This role of being the righteous one came out of nowhere and served to interrupt what I thought would be an unending series of monotonous, repetitive days. I acted the role of righteousness to perfection, but I haven't the faintest idea what the view is like on the other side of the sentence. At any rate, everything will return to normal from tomorrow. Even for myself, outside of this memory of having decided somebody should die, everything will assuredly be as it originally was. This is what I hope.
The waxing and waning of this moon is dangerous. Beware. Today is one in which accidents are prone to happen. This is what the moon is saying. No, nothing. Just talking to myself. Flower viewing? Whenever you want. How is that any of your business? Look, I'll have my secretary find an open evening for you. Are you happy now? What? No, not yet. You don't have to tell me. I know. I know everything about it. The official from the Ministry of Justice is satisfied to have cornered me in any way, and he leaves me the minister's chamber, barely concealing his smiles. Officials, they're disgusting. And that's not all. The Prime Minister is disgusting. The government is disgusting. Human life is disgusting. Meh. There's no point in listing one's complaints. I should stop. The weather must have something to do with my becoming this negative. This April has been too cold. If it continues like this, the color of the cherry blossoms will cause any number of people to go running in the wrong direction. Psychologically. Maybe I'll be one of them. Perhaps I should appear on one of those debate programs on television and blather on ad nauseum to my heart's content about anything that crosses my mind. The cherry petals scattered in the wind are responsible for everything. This won't do. This time of year is always bad. I have to get over it. If I can get through this period, I shall continue living this year as a responsible, warm, and sincere adult. I don't think anybody knows this, but I'm a very feminine man. Clearly much more a feminine man than a masculine woman. This doesn't mean I'm gay. I'm not a homosexual. I do hide this femininity. I don't believe I've ever discussed this with anybody before, but whom am I talking with now? Yes, the cherry blossoms were in bloom when my father committed suicide. He was a controversial figure as a member of the hardline faction and believed that he had lost an intra-party power struggle. He hanged himself in a hotel while on an election tour. Next to his bed, there was a sword that the right wing had given him. I can guess what happened. He doubtlessly took the blade with him to commit harakiri, but he didn't have the courage to actually do it. I've done what I can to distance myself from my father by affiliating myself politically with the moderate left. I've only just realized that my involvement with the movement to abolish the death sentence is connected with my father's death. I wonder why I was unaware of it until now, but it's clear that I made no attempt to recognize the connection. My father was a heavy drinker, and so am I. I attempted to hide this from my supporters, but they somehow got wind of this and have been rebuking me and scolding me ever since my father's time. The nature of their comments is as follows. Cut back on your drinking. It's what killed your father. There's no question that he had tied the bed sheets to the ventilator grill and that he was stinking drunk when he put them around his neck. At the same time, however, I kept repeating the same objection in my mind. What killed my father was the nation. And so I drink whiskey alone in my study in the evenings. I clear my head with whiskey and consider my next move. The study is dark, but my shadow is thrown against the wall. The whiskey is well-known single malt from Ireland that my father loved. I tried a number of different whiskeys, but this was the one I ended up drinking. Another reason I don't like this season is that whenever I'm in my study like this, I always feel that my father will emerge from the shadows on the wall. I have no desire to become another Hamlet. It's perfectly clear that the time is out of joint with this country. Shall I tell you the truth? Ultimately, I have no political doctrine of any sort. It's my job to string together a list of words, which I then perform here and there. Should anybody ask me about the contents, I can summarize them within the time for a public service commercial. As of the moment, there are 5 execution decrees on the minister's desk. Once I sign them, the process is complete. The me that takes up a pen to sign them is no longer me. I am the state. I am the nation. How preposterous is that? This clearly stinks of a strategy by the prime minister's group. I was absorbed in reading the court records of somebody condemned to death. The case had created a huge stir as it was an indiscriminate murder. Along with the feeling that there was no way I could forgive him, the ideology of the anti-capital punishment stance was left in fragments when I was set up as the state. My revenge is adrift. I shall place a collection of poetry on top of the execution decrees. It's something I received last week at a high school reunion. The self-styled poet handed the book to me. He was somebody I had never spoken with in school, and we had never interacted in any way. At the time, I was the student body president, and he was a strange sort. He never spoke and didn't stand out. He told me that the collection had just been published, and the smiling expression on his face as he presented it to me was disturbingly ominous. I think he must have seen that I was somehow wary, for he then said, "I've been watching you for a long time." Internally, I froze, but nevertheless responded with a loud laugh. He watched me intently as I laughed, with eyes that I felt could see through my shirt to the goosebumps beneath. I left the book of poetry in my briefcase for a long time. Crimes from the depths of night and punishments of the morning. What a horrid title. I shouldn't be distracted by this sort of thing. I'm trying to fulfill my role as the nation.
On my days off, I always want to be in the sun. I get up earlier than anybody else at home and walk to a park about 20 minutes away. Particularly in a summer like this, my walks can only be taken in the mornings. There's a large reservoir pond in the park, and the many trees surrounding it are covered in leaves. The surface of the green water glitters and sparkles in the sunshine. I raise both arms and attempt to inhale the water's energy. If I walk around the reservoir and enter into the depths of the trees, I arrive at a tree I like very much. The first time I passed this tree, I realized that it seemed as if it wanted to speak with me about something, and so I spent a long time standing in front of him. I couldn't understand what he was trying to tell me. I then opened my arms as if to hug the tree and pressed my body as close to it as possible. I could tell that the tree breathed a sigh of relief. This is how I started my relationship with the tree. The tree talks about a variety of things. He talks about what has happened around him over the last century, as well as experiences he's had. He says that many friends have been cut down, and he alone remains and still lives. I tell the tree of my daily work and life. Today, the tree stood bathing in the light of a July morning. The first thing I did was to stand in a pool of light falling next to the tree and to remove all of the toxins and poisons that have accumulated in my body. I then breathe deeply and absorb as much energy from the tree and sun as possible. When this ends, I hug the tree and told him about myself and the previous day. Yesterday, there was an execution, the first in a long time, and I was the one responsible for everything. This means I can take time off this week. I so seldom have time off. But even if I should physically have time off, my mind continues to turn away. What should I do? The tree remains silent. Like always, the tree never answers any of my questions. I continue to speak. I no longer understand this person that is myself as I do this. I cannot perceive the compromise between this self that has executed somebody and the self that is now behaving completely normally after having done so. With this, the tree whispered, "Nothing will change." I was startled, constrained to hear more. "There is no reason to change. All that will happen is that you will have done your job. With the completion of this job, you will experience fatigue. That is the only change you will experience. After your fatigue, you will return to normal." After saying this, the tree remained silent. I remained pressed to the tree for a while, but with what I perceived as a sign of a bird call from above, I left the tree to walk around the pond. I tried to inhale as much sunlight as I could. As I exchanged greetings with a passing jogger, my head stopped spinning and I felt refreshed. I sat on a bench along the way. I watched the water birds. I'm not the only one. I couldn't be the only one with these thoughts. I sat on the bench telling myself that everyone of my colleagues would be out somewhere attempting to absorb the sunlight. I began to wonder why I had chosen this profession, and then I understood. It was making my head spin again. This wouldn't do, and I began to shake my head from left to right, trying to clear everything. I looked like a dog trying to shake a water out of its coat. I recognized that this was something I shouldn't pursue to any great depth, by which I mean the reasons for my having chosen to be a prison guard. This is something I haven't talked about with the tree yet. As to why I haven't discussed this with the tree, it's because whenever I imagine myself telling this to the tree, I always think that should I reach this point, I will have lost the ability to recover myself. I shake my head like a dog again and stand up from the bench to begin walking. He floated through my mind. He must already know about yesterday's execution. Now it's a question of whether or not his attitude will change with the execution. I have told the tree about him and his refusal to open up. The tree said nothing in reply. I also told the tree about the history of the persecution and atrocities that have befallen us. I wondered if I hugged the tree whether he would begin to talk again, but I would then need to talk about myself, regardless of being aware that I may be unable to recover myself. But to make that sort of effort, I can only wonder what I am trying to extract from him. I really shouldn't say this, but I don't believe one bit in the prisoner's expressions of guilt or remorse for their crimes. As to why I don't believe in this, I've arrived back in front of my house. I shake my head to clear everything from it. I don't think my head will spin for the rest of the day. This is because I've bathed in sunlight. Everybody at home wants me to remain the same as ever. Once the holidays are over, I'll give it my best.
Over the last few days, I've entered the dream again. Even if you should kill me, I don't think I'd experience anything in the way of pain. When I told him about this, the expression on his face looked like that of a confused child caught standing between a bully and the target of his aggression. Of the different expressions he has, this is the one I like the most. I made my final blow. "Why don't you execute me immediately?" He left in silence. I saw the tears welling in his eyes. A cliché one often hears from murderers is that they felt as if they were in a dream at the time. That was the first thing I said in the interrogation room. The policeman looked disgusted with me, as if he were about to say, "Here's another one." "And now that your eyes have opened, what do you think about what you've done?" That's what the policeman asked. This was unexpected. I was still in the dream at that time. I was in this dream the entire time I was in jail. Even when I was moved to the detention center, I was in the dream for the entire trip in the police van. Even at the courthouse, I was in the dream. But, of course, it wasn't possible to remain sleeping. I awoke when I was truly sleeping. The face of my victim as he suffered appeared before my eyes. I clearly heard the scream. This was undoubtedly real. I felt the blood on my palms. My mind was blank from the guilt of having done something terrible, and my heart was beating so that my entire body pulsed. I was running down a straight path, a path with nothing around it. This all took place in my dream. I was sweating, but at no point did I awaken. All I did was run in my sleep until it was time for me to get out of bed. Sleeping and being awake had become reversed. Reality was the dream, and the rawness of reality kept repeating within the world of sleep. Because of this, I could only truly experience the guilt of my crime in the world of REM sleep. Change occurred after I had been sentenced and moved to this cell. I was hearing birds singing from the window of the detention center. I was shaken by the sound of a bird call I had heard somewhere at some point in the past. The awareness that I was somebody that had done something no human being should ever do roiled throughout my body. I couldn't remain in my ordinary state imagining the appearance of this bird that I didn't even know the name of. What I did, this crime, erased this bird call from eternity. What I mean is that I crushed it. Hearing the sound of wailing, he entered. I had been screaming, "I'm sorry, I'm so sorry." I could tell that he had touched my back. I stopped my weeping, and when I turned to look at him, he was looking at me with a gentle smile. He looked satisfied. At that moment, however, I had half returned to my dream. The following day, I was, as always, completely in this dream. The scenery in front of me had been drawn on thin pieces of paper. When I tried to touch them, they passed through the air and there was no sensation of actual touch. They were things I could only see. The sense of guilt dissolved into fragments, and as I had forgotten that I had been crying, even if the word remorse was to be placed in front of me, I would have only stared at it in a daze. It seemed as if he was deeply disappointed in me again. Nevertheless, I transformed the birdsong into a spot or a border where occasionally the realness of the real world was resuscitated. There was no rule or sort of notice as to when this would happen. It would happen suddenly and kick me down to writhe in the awareness of remorse. It is winter. The Thursday outbreak of resurrection didn't vanish, even by the following day. It continued into Saturday, and today it is already Monday. I am perfectly immersed in a world that neighbors death. This is my unquestionable reality. The face of the robber murderer in the cell next to mine who had been executed this last summer came to mind. With the fear of his death, his body shook, and the darkness of night was the final blow. My sleep was disturbed. He had me copying sutras. When I said I hated it, he gave me Crime and Punishment to read. I didn't think I was in a psychological state to read, but when I opened the page, the print jumped out with surprising smoothness. This was the complete opposite of what he had hoped to accomplish with his scheme. The experience of fiction after so long enticed me to the world of dreams again, and I was able to return to a tranquil life devoid of reality. Fear has vanished. This is when I want to be executed. I'm fairly sure that he has misunderstood this request. I feel sorry for him. He should realize fairly soon that, as a human being, I am far above him. A helicopter is flying at low altitude. There must have been a big accident of some sort. The cell is shaking from the helicopter's vibrations. Is this reality? If it is reality, what sort of reality is it?
The four men are silent. Scene three.
Well, what do we do now?
Silence.
Indeed, what do we do?
What about exchanging our roles?
We can't continue as is.
Let's continue just a bit longer.
Can we do that?
I'm fine.
Do you mean that as you've had enough?
I mean it as in I approve.
In that case, let's continue. Why haven't you read the poetry collection?
Well, that's abrupt.
It's the one bit that's been bothering me more than anything else.
That's because it has no meaning.
Even though you were writing this during high school?
So is this the setting?
Are you completely against it?
If we are to continue the scene with you as the one who published the collection, I have no problems.
I see. That's perfect. If one can say something is perfect, that's very good. So, I'm the one who is the former eccentric that gives you the book.
If you don't like it, you don't have to do it.
No, that's fine, that's fine. Then we are classmates.
Can I talk about what I'm to do?
Of course, please.
Why haven't you executed me?
Why am I the target of all the barbs?
You're the minister. What do you expect?
So, why haven't you executed me?
I'm thinking of starting a research group.
You're a timid one, aren't you?
And you're a frank one, aren't you?
I'm going to die anyway, so I can say whatever I want, can't I?
History is made by the timid.
What does that mean?
The timid consider things carefully.
Ah, but of course, I see.
Have you finished reading Crime and Punishment?
Yes.
What did you think?
I thought it was long.
If there's a book you'd like to read after this, let me know.
At the moment, there's nothing in particular.
Is timidity why you're not moving forward on approving the execution?
We're still on this topic?
Think of it as the tenacity of the eccentric.
Precisely why I want to have a research group before anything else.
If your personal emotions are holding up the execution, the juror's anxiety has all been for nothing, a wasted effort. You know, stress has this serious lasting effect.
I do know.
I believe that I was the first of the jurors to be against this. As for why, what was the reason?
What did you do?
An indiscriminate murder. Why are you asking me at this point?
I just wanted to make sure.
This is what it's been about from the start, isn't it? There isn't any other possibility, is there? Am I mistaken?
No, you're not.
No, you're not.
I think I was against the sentence because I didn't feel this motive was deeply understood. If there had been a grudge or some enmity, I would have understood. How can one human being judge another human being without having understood the motive? Murder without a grudge or enmity is like killing somebody in war.
War is also subject to judgment.
The losers are unmistakably subject to judgment. The winners and their untold slaughter, however, are never subjected to judgment.
You shouldn't get too worked up over this.
I don't understand. In the end, I don't understand myself. I don't know why I did it. I don't even understand how I should be feeling remorse.
You robbed somebody of something.
What did I take?
A human life.
And what is a human life?
You brought a human existence to a sudden end.
A human existence?
Yes.
You did the same thing as well, didn't you?
Look, this is the sort of argument that university students have.
University students. University students today don't argue.
You did the same thing as well, didn't you?
What does that have to do with anything?
You hanged somebody, didn't you? What did you do? Put on the blindfold? Place the rope around his neck? Please answer. According to everything I've heard, the executioner's second is a difficult role. You have to stabilize the body after it's been dropped from above and prevent it from swinging. You have to hold those bodies that are still warm. You hold those criminals who waver in the narrow space between life and death. For those bodies on their way to death, you are the last human touch.
I think we should stop here.
So, basically, we have two murderers here, and we see each other every day. We should shake hands on that.
I'm leaving.
He
left.
All I did was try and discuss this with him.
You tried to discuss this with him?
Don't you like discussion?
What do you mean? I'm a politician.
Then by all means, let's talk.
You discussed his executions in the same terms as war, but it's not as if the state ordered him to do what he did.
He was ordered to do this.
What? You were ordered to do this?
I don't know.
He executed these people under orders from the state. The state in question, however, was a private nation state of his own making.
I can't keep up with this. Is this really true?
I don't really know.
He created an internal nation state that only he can understand.
I can't bear listening to this. Is this really true?
I'm thinking about it.
You see, it becomes a question of whether or not the laws of our nation can pass judgment on him. And because of this, at first, I was opposed to his death sentence.
I've had it. I've truly had it.
He starts to leave.
Could you please return the poetry collection then? You're not going to read it after all.
Here, it's yours. I don't need this thing.
One of your poems is included. The title, Crimes from the Depths of Night and Punishments of the Morning, is from a poem you wrote then. I stole it. I stole you. Please don't leave yet. Let's finish this.
I'll stay then.
That's the spirit.
He's not coming back. He really left, didn't he?
He's not coming back.
He won't be back. He's disappeared.
But the development will come to a dead stop.
The development?
We can't continue with only three people.
We can't have one more person join us?
No, rules are rules.
What shall we do?
Indeed. What do we do?
Silence.
Well, what should we do?
Let's try and finish this.
What if we exchange our roles?
It couldn't hurt.
Let's do it.
The man who brought the black box re-enters. He positions the box, bows politely, and exits.
So it's a retake.
A redo.
You're sure this is permitted?
It's fine.
Well, if that's the case.
My apologies.
Why did you run away?
I was very confused.
Is there a problem of some sort?
I was a bit worn out. This exchange of roles is most welcome.
I don't want to do this too many times.
Then this is the one exception.
You're not the only one who finds this difficult.
This is very true, you know.
That's why I've apologized.
The four men insert their hands into the box, remove the paper slips, and open them. The four men go to their respective positions. Scene four.
The dizziness hasn't stopped. The first wave arrives in the evening. With sunset, pools of fatigue sink through my body to its very core, and emptiness creeps in. But I find that in talking with colleagues, I am diverted. The problem is the second wave, which strikes in the dead of night. The spinning is truly like a tsunami. It surges and recedes again and again, and the spinning runs around in my head until dawn, completely destroying the calm composure I had during the day.
The spinning never bothers me when I'm at work. I therefore asked the head of the department to increase my night shifts, but working every night was clearly impossible. Vertigo always begins just as everyone at home falls asleep. I don't know what to do. I can't remain still, but at the same time, I have no idea what to do with myself. Unable to settle, I fret and fuss alone in silence. There's some small person in my head raising a racket as he runs wild from place to place. That evening, I ended up stealing out of the house without a noise and headed to the park. The call of the insects poured over me like heavy rain. The surface of the reservoir was black. The branches of the trees and their silhouettes stretched over the water. I started with a fright when I thought one of the silhouettes on a branch suddenly looked like a human. The spinning in my head had painted the apparition of a human body hanging from a branch. Should you ask me if the enactment of a punishment is comic or tragic? I don't think I could say that it's tragic. It's a job determined by the law, and neither the gods nor the fates have anything to do with it. There is one instance in which it is clearly a tragedy. This is when a prisoner is executed under false charges. This tragedy happens with greater frequency than one would think. With the passage of time, prison guards know who has been imprisoned on false charges. In discussing the possibilities of the comic, I imagine what could call the whole institutionalization of the death sentence a bad joke. The sight of those people who take this joke seriously is unquestionably a comedy. I'm perfectly aware that the more frantic those people involved are, the more comedy it becomes. For me to be speaking like this clearly disqualifies me as a prison guard, and I would lose my job the moment those in upper echelons knew of it. Nevertheless, my desire to talk about this isn't going to vanish. I think of this as my treatment for the spinning in my head. This is something humans do, and there are those things humans do that are failures. Can you understand this? The failure of the death sentence will be remembered as a black comedy and a pitch black comedy. I witnessed a black comedy. Furthermore, it was my first execution and it came without warning. It was my job to place the rope around the prisoner's neck. It was my first significant responsibility. I have no idea if those above were entertaining great expectations of me or if it was maliciousness on their part. After a night without sleep, I faced the day of execution. The prisoner, a male, had murdered somebody during a robbery, and he spent his days reading the Bible after having converted to Christianity a few years ago. It wasn't his supervisor, but we had exchanged a few words. His eyes were gentle. We didn't think he could act violently, even when he heard that he would be executed. As we expected, he mounted the block with a firm step. When I placed the noose around his neck, after his head had been covered, my entire body was shaking. I heard him whispering something. The hanging block was removed, but he didn't die. Normally, they die 20 minutes after they start having convulsions. M, the person whose role it was to stabilize the body the minute it dropped, cried out. The hanged man was flapping his legs about. The movements were not those of convulsions. The rope is caught on his chin, called M. I hadn't affixed the noose properly. I saw the head of the prison and the public prosecutor start up in their panic. Get him down, M called again. The prisoner hit the ground with a thud. I ran down underneath the hanging block. M was standing with his legs straddled over the prisoner's chest. I screamed internally. M had placed his hands on the prisoner's neck to finish the job. The doctor and other guards had gathered. Unaware, I had retreated from the scene of the murder. After this, I watched the scene from over a colleague's shoulder. The doctor was taking the prisoner's pulse. The doctor pronounced the prisoner dead. M stood up, found me amongst the others and was staring at me. I bowed as deeply as possible and said, "I'm sorry." When I raised my head, M was no longer there. M was 10 years my senior. We were not close in any way and I hardly knew him. I had thought to apologize to M again at the post-execution gathering to recognize people for their services, but he didn't come. I took a leave of absence. I thought about a number of different things during my time away from work. Was it necessary for M to have done what he did? If I had been in his position, what would I have done? I returned to work after a week, but M was not there. I heard that he had been rotated to another position in the prison. The dizziness began just about this time. I headed off to where he was now working with every desire of making a proper apology to M. He wasn't there. heard from colleagues that he had quit his job as a prison guard, and being single, he returned home to live with his mother. I went to visit him at home. M, as I suspected, wasn't there either. According to what his mother told me, he had become psychologically unstable and therefore hospitalized. I asked where the hospital was so that I could visit him, but she told me that he should be left in peace for the moment and didn't tell me where it was. Standing in front of the tree, my conversation partner. At night, the tree is very different from the day and much more dignified and far less welcome. I told the tree that I had completely ruined M's life. The tree said nothing to me. This silence drove the spinning from my head to the other side of the night sky.
Regardless of whatever you should be babbling on about, I can say that I enjoyed being a juror. In the television interview, I made the appropriate show of suffering and anguish over the decision. In my tedious daily life, these days spent as a juror were extremely rewarding. I'm always excited when I experience something for the first time, and I gained a sense of confidence in myself. The confidence that arises from being needed. This was a sensation I had completely forgotten. Those special days that suddenly rain down on me in the course of one's life, I still remember him clearly. I can still see the expression on his face and his behavior when we pass the death sentence. I've never talked about this with anybody, not even my wife. From the very beginning, she exercised complete indifference to my being a juror. I'm grateful to her for this. I remained silent. I buried this unforgettable image of him in the depths of my consciousness. I assumed it would vanish after a while. That's what I thought. There was, however, unexpected development in the waiting. I would like to tell you about that this evening. On my way home from work, my colleague, S, and I went for a drink after not having seen each other for a long time. S called me to work the week before to ask me out. S is the same age I am, and he and I had worked for many years in the same accounting department. That year, however, he had moved on to general affairs. He moved on in the world a bit more than I had. When he and I were still in accounting, we would occasionally go for a drink, but after he had shifted departments, we gradually grew apart. S said that he wanted to go to a pricey yakitori place. When I looked reluctant, he said, "Don't worry about it." S ate and drank without restraint. S caught up in his enthusiasm. I ate and drank as well. Our conversation was not animated, but S suddenly began to speak. He told me that his wife had found out about his affair with somebody in the office. I sighed to myself. Not because of what S was telling me, but because of his attitude in the telling. "My wife left me," S flatly announced. "I see." This was the only thing I could say. With this, S started to say something very strange. "She hasn't left, but she's left." "She's left or she hasn't left?" "Well, it doesn't really matter." And he downed a glass of awamori on ice. There was something that struck me as nostalgic about the expression on his face. It reminded me of the sense of emptiness my father embodied. The thought that this was how men lived their lives in today's world floated into my mind. They matured by facing a continuous stream of empty days. This caused me to somehow recall his face, and I wondered if he had experienced too many days of emptiness before he aged. I was confident that it was my turn to speak. What poured from my mouth was the endless stream of days as a juror, and the climax was the death sentence. "Are you allowed to talk to me about this?" asked S. "No, it's forbidden," I answered. "Well, if that's the case, shut the fuck up. Why are you telling me this?" I was startled at how threatened he seemed when he looked down. "You're not to speak of this, ever. Take it with you to your grave. Take it with you." He then enfolded my hand in both of his and said, "Don't talk about it. You are never to talk about this." I was so surprised by this that I remained unable to speak a single word and drank. I stood as if to go to the restroom, took a deep breath, and said, "Let's go." Despite my insistence upon splitting the bill, S got the better of me and paid for everything. We walked to the closest underground station. On the way, S muttered, "This is a clean break." When I asked, "What is?" he answered, "I'm thinking of writing a letter," and then fell into silence. S and I were standing on the platform waiting for the train to arrive. Just as the train emerged and The front of the car could be seen. S turned to me and, with a faint smile, said, "See you. Sorry about this." S vanished. The train immediately blocked everything from my field of vision. I told the police everything exactly as it unfolded in front of me. They didn't detain me. S left a wife of the same age and two grown daughters. The funeral was a simple one. His death was announced as an accident. I was under the impression that I could be the only one who knew the truth. This then led to unexpected fantasies of my having committed adultery with his wife, and that the concern he was experiencing, and then led to trouble between the two of us on the platform. It wasn't as if he had said anything along these lines to me, but I was nonetheless in agony over these imagined rumors and was unable to pay my final respects to S in his coffin. I even imagined that I could hear people attending the funeral whispering to each other that I had pushed S in the back that night. He hadn't left a will. The realization that I was the only person to have heard him speak his last words haunted me even more. The setting for my first nightmare was the same evening at that same platform. A man crawled up from the space between the platform and the train. He was covered in blood. When he raised his head, it wasn't S. It was the face of the man sentenced to death. The tedium of my daily life with these recurring nightmares became truly an excruciating tedium. In my dreams, he would always sit in the same seat at the counter in the bar. Not S, but him. S had already vanished. It was the prisoner before he was sentenced. But I found this incomprehensible. If it had been S, I would have somehow found it more convincing. At work, I submitted a request for a leave of absence. The happy shouts of the university became a distant buzzing in my ears. I started seeing a psychiatrist.
At some point, I shall assuredly become prime minister. If that idiot is fit for the job, there's no reason I can't do it. Compared to my father's time, the job of prime minister has become considerably easier. As long as I maintain a solid side guard and remain in the public's eye often enough, my turn will come round. Those whose performances are overly conspicuous become tabloid fodder. Originally, I despised standing out. But ever since childhood, everybody always said I wanted to stand out, but this was the fault of my father. Given that my father was the local star, the celebrity, it was only normal that his son should also shine with the same light. In junior and senior high school, I became class president for my father. And even though I yearned to be a proper delinquent at a preparatory school, I graduated with distinction and high honors. All of this was for my father. Stand above others, assume leadership. This was a favorite phrase of my father. My ideal was that, as I despised placing restraints on myself, other people should remain free of any constraints and do as they wished. And with the education my father provided me as I was growing up, I became an excellent manager. This is to say, my father developed this talent in me. The principles of politics were also something my father instilled. My father was an intransigent nationalist, but realizing that this would not take him far in the world, he assumed the role of being a moderate, if nonetheless a member of the hardliner faction. He supported the death penalty, or perhaps I should say that as Minister of Justice, he recognized it and in a positive light. Given that what I'm about to say is something anybody could find out with some research, I feel I should disclose this rather than attempt to hide it. Yes, my father was Minister of Justice, and during his term of office, he approved the execution of 7 prisoners. My father sentenced these prisoners without any hesitation, and this was something I admired. This was, after all, the Minister of Justice's job. My father was a candidate for Prime Minister in the following period. After having completed his term as just Minister of Justice, he should have immediately advanced to the highest position. But something happened to my father, and nobody outside of my father knows what this was. After he hanged himself, the people who had surrounded him suggested that it was a psychological weakness of his. They all commented that he had been acting the role of being a powerful and resilient man. This is idiotic. It's obvious. And any male that appears strong and resilient is performing. There's no such thing as a male that's strong and resilient from the beginning. This tale has muddled strength with ruthless cruelty and callousness. This confused story is the history of strong, resilient men. I determined to live my life differently from how my father lived his, This decision then became my armor, and outwardly, I appeared to be a strong politician. I can do this. At this time next year, I shall be prime minister in solving the problems the nation faces with the greatest of ease and efficiency. I shall work my fingers to the bone for the people. But shall I tell you the truth? Shall I tell you what the truth is here and now? There are those who strike admirable poses and say admirable things, but by and large, most of us think the people of this country are all stupid. I'm drunk. I am drunk once again this evening from too much Irish whiskey.
He withdraws the poetry collection, opens to a page, and reads.
Morning. I awoke having become a criminal. Night. Everything I had done as an honest individual had in the evening become a crime. Morning. I experienced the sensation of my sin. In my dreams, the one who had committed an unforgivable action was me, and therefore, I was suspended, floating between the honesty of the night and the actions of dreams. When I repudiated my dreams for sincerity and honesty, sincerity is no longer sincerity. I, who am trying to live an honest life, awake in the morning having become a criminal. And by noon, I have become a truly splendid criminal. But is there anybody who can judge me? Is there somebody who can punish me? I wrote this. I did. That's stupid. Shall I tell you the truth? The argument for the abolishment of the death penalty is fundamentally flawed.
He moves as if to rip a page from the book, but stops and stares at a spot.
Ah, you hear, Dad? Father, you are right. I shall fulfill my dream, I shall fulfill my duties as minister. I shall soon be prime minister. I'm different from you. I'm strong. Tomorrow, I shall approve an execution. First, I shall send the murderer to his execution. He's the only one I cannot forgive, ever.
The head prison guard. It's going to be a week since he stopped coming. He's broken his promise to bring me the next meeting. Kafka on the shore. I don't understand why he chose that after Crime and Punishment. It must be his taste in literature. This life I lead is the perfect environment for reading full-length novels. And I have heaps of time to think. The only regrettable thing is that there is nowhere for me to put to use what I have learned through reading. There are times when I no longer understand why I have been kept alive. Regardless of what I think, there is no place for those on death row to live meaningfully. There are no options. There was only the road leading to death. When I talked to him about these things, his response was that ultimately, this is what humans face. It may appear as if there are a variety of paths to take, but all humans march towards death, and there's nothing we can do to escape this fate. In our attempt to establish some sort of mastery over this fear, we do different things. We think different things. I had a better opinion of him after that. He impulsively promoted a humanism of sorts. It's not as if he were the good guy trying to get me to reflect upon what I had done. Nevertheless, in the end, he brought up the subject of my repentance. You should draw some sort of connection between everything you've thought about here and your reflections over your crime, along with your reconciliation with the victims and the bereaved family. With this, I tossed him a malicious grin. And as always, he left in silence. What I wanted to say was that I have repented more than he could ever realize. The problem is that I have no idea how to express this, having observed prisoners who spend their entire existence in remorse and guilt. For some reason, this has become the mannerism of remorse and guilt, and there's nothing I can do if it looks like mere pretense. As long as people do not show behavior that fails to conform to expected stereotypical appearances, their true essence will never be understood. I suffer remorse. At the same time, to merely state that I suffer remorse is insufficient to express the depths of my remorse. It's not so simple to reduce the act of taking the lives of utter strangers to remorse. I have no desire to reduce it to something so simplistic. So what should I do? I should die. This is what should happen. Who will kill me? I, who cannot live according to conformity, will be killed by conformity. But I am kept alive. So I thought to injure myself on a daily basis. I banged my head against the wall until I was covered in blood. This body should be destroyed. My existence should be effaced. He didn't come again today. I wonder if what I had said hit him somewhere near the core of his existence. No, that can't be the only thing. The week before there was an execution, something must have happened then. I have thought about the life I took. At the very best, the right of a human being to take the life of another human being doesn't exist. I should be executed immediately. And with this, I, who have been forced to live, will hang on. I'm stuck.
What's wrong?
I can't continue.
You can do whatever you like.
I've lost my place and I don't know what to do.
What do you mean?
I don't know if I should draw upon the earlier personality or if I should create a completely new personality.
You should probably draw upon the earlier personality to some degree, but the rest is up to you.
The image of the earlier role I played is too strong.
I agree.
But you're doing so well.
Well, we've been doing some of it under duress. We can no longer concentrate.
This is true. I can't concentrate.
That's not really so, is it?
I've lost my bearings.
Shall we return to our earlier roles?
I think we should.
That's much appreciated.
What should we do?
If everybody agrees, I have no problems.
In that case, let's return to the original arrangement.
The four men move to their respective positions. Scene 5. The four are persistently and annoyingly quiet.
So, is there any reason for this? This silence?
His words are still being absorbed.
His words?
The words of our predecessor. They shouldn't be forgotten.
They shouldn't be forgotten, should they?
What shouldn't be forgotten?
My setting. The person before passed it on to me.
Well, it's not as if it hasn't already been spoken of, you know.
It's terrifying.
Can't you let me do as I please?
In that case, create a new model.
That's out of the question. There's no mistake that has already been referred to.
We're screwed.
The four drop back into silence.
We've reached the dead end, haven't we?
What do you think we should do?
Let's talk.
What shall we talk about?
Ourselves. That's about the only thing there is when one is looking for something to talk about.
Is this sarcasm?
No, it's truth.
Well, in that case, there's only one thing. We should talk about that.
You mean you want to talk about that?
Yes, that.
Then please talk about that.
We aren't here to do that. It's not our purpose. What does everybody think? Do you want to talk about it?
I'm fine with it. Shall we talk about it then?
I don't want to listen to it.
This is true. I don't want to listen to it either.
In that case, we should continue with what we're doing. Do you have any objections?
He withdraws the pieces of paper and displays them.
This is what we are doing. We're going to finish this. Take one.
In that case, I should return to work.
He begins to leave and asks the juror,
what about you?
I've taken time off from work.
Did you?
I just returned, but I doubt if I'll fit in anymore.
I'm the one who is responsible for that.
All I wanted to do was lead a reasonably peaceful life, but then when something like this happens, I gave up.
My apologies.
There's nothing to apologize for.
Well, I have a cabinet meeting now.
Where are you going?
To a cabinet meeting.
That I understood, but where do you think you are going?
Ah, I see what you mean, indeed.
He stops. Scene 5. The four men go to their respective positions. They have become accustomed to their roles, and the earlier formality has decreased.
Hey, good morning. You haven't said anything. What's up?
What's with this what's up?
I brought the book.
And where did you vanish to?
I was given a break.
Well, aren't you special?
Far from it.
Did you have a good time?
How could I possibly have a good time?
I was beginning to worry. You have already witnessed one execution.
As I was saying.
I was afraid that you wouldn't be on duty for my execution.
What do you mean by saying that?
I'm afraid. I want you to be there. I want to die by your side.
The guard hugs the prisoner from behind.
I can hear it. I can hear your voice. I can hear your true voice.
What can you hear?
Your body is talking to me. It's telling me of all the horrible treatment you've experienced.
Please stop.
I'm the only one who can hear your past, this history of you that is your entire body.
I'm not a tree in a park.
Don't make fun of trees.
I'm a human being.
Trees live longer than humans. They understand far more than we. I won't let go.
The prisoner separates from the guard, but resembles a spirit leaving a body in an out-of-body experience. The guard looks as if he is still holding the prisoner from behind.
I was an only child with a dream. Most only children are raised to have dreams, but this tendency or inclination was particularly strong with me. All of our relatives had large families, and ours was the only one with an only child. Because of this, whenever the family gathered, we were treated differently. And I always felt that the term only child was somehow discriminatory. Whenever I cried or whined about something, the immediate response was, only children are like this. My father once overheard somebody say, and blatantly, that only children have bad personalities. I don't know if it is because of this, but I increasingly immersed myself in imaginary worlds, and the boundary between reality and fantasy vanished. Fantasy was the sole world in which I existed. My father was an alcoholic, and he committed suicide when I was 15. My mother raised me on her own and put me through university. But my childhood memories of my mother are of her abuse. There was doubtless the stress of having a husband dependent upon alcohol. She chastised and scolded me on a daily basis. When she became hysterical, she would pretend to throw me from a window on the first floor, drag me about by my hair. She was truly terrifying. To escape this awful reality, I created a world for myself alone. And with this, I tried to purge myself of all memories of my mother. The incident, this was something that occurred in the world I had constructed for myself up to that point. There were emotions. These emotions, however, were those that had been nourished in my world. I was running on the street wielding a knife. In my world, this day was a festival. The voices of those shouting as they fled trying to escape sounded like laughter. To my ears, these were the cries made by the sacred palanquin bearers as they made their way through a neighborhood. When I saw the copious amounts of blood from the victims, the hues and tints of my world suddenly changed. At that moment, I finally and unmistakably acquired a true sense of reality. But the time I was in the detention house, as I waited for sentencing, allowed me a space in which to once again seclude myself in the world I had created. I saw the trial as a gathering of aliens. After the sentencing, I entered this prison, at which point a change took place. Those memories of my mother and her abuse that had been so carefully locked away were once again clear. They had been restored. With this, for the first time, I was aware of the real world, and I was able to recognize and appreciate my crime. I was finally able to experience remorse.
Can I ask you something about your father?
Yes, of course.
I was wondering if your father's death had some connection.
At the time, I didn't think so, but as a son, I think the impact of my father's death had a role. I wondered if I wouldn't die the same way when I reached his age. In the end, for me, my father was reality, the true appearance of my father as an alcoholic. My mother tried to hide the truth from the world and from me. With my father's death, the path to reality was severed. I wandered on so many different paths, but finally, I feel that I have become an honest man, and honest citizen. I feel that I can live as a human being. That's all I have to say.
What is this?
Indeed. It was a collage of testimony heard at court. Everybody remembers this, do they not?
Basically what you're saying is that it's the fault of the parents and how they raised the child. I don't understand this. What does this mean?
I'm the last person you should be asking.
I'll go and visit you next time. Is that all right?
What is there to talk about when we meet?
I haven't decided.
I don't understand what you mean.
The idea that after passing judgment, that's the end, that it's over, this doesn't make sense.
Your role is finished, isn't it? You thought about it and thought deeply and then passed judgment. Becoming weak-kneed at this point means we have no place here. You understand this, don't you?
I do, yes.
Humans made this decision, and thus this is something that humans have to do. It's something you never speak of to anyone. It's something you forget.
I want to meet him so that I can forget.
In that case, forget that you ever met. Do you understand?
Yes.
The juror draws near the prisoner.
Hey!
Thank you very much.
Huh?
You're the one that made the judgment, aren't you?
Yes.
Precisely why I'm thanking you. What was the final factor in the decision?
The final factor?
The final factor in passing the verdict.
The fact that all those people were killed.
Really?
Do you resent me or somehow blame me for this?
I haven't time for that.
Because of your involvement in this, I've been thinking. I've been wondering if humans have the right to judge or decide who should live and who should die.
What is it you want to say? What are you trying to tell me?
I don't know.
Go away.
At first, I was the only juror against your verdict of the death sentence. I'm unsure how to put it, but it made me feel inexpressibly good. As the trial progressed, my initial good feelings toward you gradually vanished. I began to feel that you were a repulsive, disgusting man. And because of this, I voted in favor of the death sentence. I formulated my own understanding, a logic that I found convincing. It is permissible for humans to take a life of one who has taken the life of another.
The sole purpose of your coming here is to tell me this?
What I'm trying to say is that if you had become a better person in this place, I would deeply regret my decision.
This place is not an environment in which people become good. It's a horrible place. The everyday is incomprehensible. I completely fail to understand the very meaning of daily existence. The act of awakening itself is a continual source of despair. What purpose is there in my life? I live to be executed. I live waiting for my execution. What is this life? Living a life devoid of all meaning is torture. I now understand the meaning of this system. The time spent waiting to be hanged, this torture, is the compensation for the crime.
You're only thinking of yourself.
Don't you understand that this system is making me what I am? It's disgusting. Fucking condescending bastards. The only thing you've been asked to do is serve jury duty. What's the basis for your right to judge me? Are you such outstanding examples of humanity?
No, I'm not, but that's why I came to see you.
Fuck off.
Good. I made the correct decision. I was right.
You, please leave.
I can now forget about this jackass.
You think you can forget about me? I'll follow you to the day you die.
Stop screwing around. Even if I should be able to forget you, but him, I can never.
The three men, disturbed by the juror's odd behavior, watch him closely.
Are you all right?
Fine. You should rest for a bit. I'm fine. My apologies. All right, let's continue. My interview was finished. It's your turn.
I think you should probably take a break.
I told you I'm fine. How about hurrying up and making the decision to approve the execution?
Have we started?
Answer me, Minister!
It's not so easy. I won't be releasing any sort of conclusive decision.
The conclusion has already been released. Hurry up and finish your work. I've been to see him.
By him? You mean him?
There's no room for taking the extenuating circumstances into consideration.
I have no intention of doing so.
You've been hiding your cowardice in the armor of liberalism. Return the poetry collection. It's not as if you're going to read it.
I wrote those poems.
You admit it!
Why did you publish those things?
Why?
Yes, why?
Because you are me. Don't you understand? You have always been another me, ever since secondary school.
I see.
Go visit him.
You are...
Yes, I am the director of the prison board.
It must be a challenging job.
People can only stand it for about 3 years.
I've just started this position. I've been thinking about starting a research group for this system.
What good will research be?
To begin with, we need to know more.
And once you know more?
We can consider whether or not the system is justifiable.
And what good will this consideration do?
I'd like to hear the opinion of somebody who actually works there, such as yourself.
And listening to my opinion will do what?
I'd like to use it as a reference.
And using my opinion as a reference will do what?
I want to ensure whether or not it's right.
And if it's wrong, what will you do?
I shall abolish it.
If you should do that, this will mean that we have been doing something fundamentally wrong all along.
And this is why I will study whether it's wrong or not.
And what will studying do?
I shall decide whether or not to abolish it and continue with it. It's necessary to discuss this at the national level.
You simply want to see the public's reaction, don't you? Please make the decision, Minister.
I need to study in order to decide.
Your research is an excuse to avoid making a decision.
Who are you?
A prison guard.
You should join my research group as a representative of somebody who works on site.
I'd be delighted to participate in the research group. Is this cabinet likely to continue?
I think you should take charge of it.
Huh?
You should take over in some fashion. Because before I cause some sort of scandal by a slip of the tongue.
I would never resort to something like that.
It's not a question of your resorting to something like that, But somebody will leak this information under the guise of having some sense of justice. And should this happen, I would be, most regrettably, dismissed.
I would never say anything.
We always destroy the things we have created. This is the way of the world here.
Please, calm down.
I am calm.
I'm sure that you're very tired, Minister.
This may be.
In that case, should anything happen, please call me.
That's greatly appreciated. He's normally a very kind man, but he's the one who is tired. He just experienced his first execution. Please forgive him.
You're a colleague of his?
I'm the convict.
What?
I'm the one sentenced to die. This is the research group, isn't it?
Yes.
I'm sure you have many questions you'd like to ask. Please feel free to do so.
What do you think about every day?
I spend my days meditating upon what I did. The only thing on my mind is atonement. And because I can no longer stand it, I've started writing letters to the family of the man I murdered. But they never write back.
Are you comfortable here?
I'm not in any position to complain. Nevertheless, it's a very nice place to be. Nice to the point where I wonder if I should be treated like this. The prison guards are all extremely kind to me. I've been able to think about a variety of things since I've come here. I feel as if I've been reborn.
I see, that's very nice. Well, this has been very informative.
Thank you. Thank you. I look forward to your future cooperation.
What cooperation is this?
I look forward to your forbearance.
What forbearance?
I am hoping for your forgiveness. I regret what I did more than you can possibly imagine. Please allow me the chance to live.
The minister suddenly grabs the prisoner by the collar and strikes him. The remaining three men are all shot.
You don't regret a damn thing.
Whoa, easy, easy, calm down.
All right, I'm fine. My apologies.
Look, I'm not him.
I'm truly sorry about that.
Well, I know how you feel.
You're bleeding.
Oh, I'll take a short break.
Well, hang on a second.
I'm not going to disappear.
Yes.
I'm truly terribly sorry.
Do you think you can continue?
I'm fine. Let's continue.
I'll take his part.
Do you mind? If that's the case, then please.
Should I start?
Yes, please do.
I'm so frightened that I have no idea how to put it into words. All I can do is tell you directly. If the execution were to take place immediately after my expression of regret, I would express as much regret as people want to hear. I'd do anything to escape this terror. What I did was the utmost in egocentrism. I thought I was the one who suffered most in this world, the height of folly. I've thought about this, and I regret it.
Well, this is promising.
Then you're...
What are you laughing about?
If that's the case, you're done for.
What?
If this is your attitude, the execution won't take place for a while.
What do you mean?
Murderers need to suffer more.
You're suffering as well, aren't you?
And that's why your execution won't happen for a while.
Can I believe you?
You want to live, don't you?
No, I'd rather you killed me immediately.
He grabs his lapel.
This isn't the place for violence.
I know. Stop using the words to kill and to be killed here.
Not being able to suppress your emotions is a bad thing, murderer.
What's it to you, murderer?
Get your hands off me, murderer.
Apologize, murderer.
Why should I, murderer?
Because of your attitude, murderer.
I'm so sorry, murderer.
He releases his hands.
I'm so glad to have seen you, so do have a lovely day.
Goodbye.
This is a trap of some sort.
You met, didn't you?
Yes, I did.
And how was it?
I've made my decision.
Have.
While in office, I will never approve an execution.
That's against the law.
Ask me if I give a damn.
What do you talk about in prison?
I met a person, one human being, not a devil or a demon.
And?
Humans cannot pass judgment on other human beings. I am not a god.
What are you babbling about at this point? This country has never had gods. From its very beginning, and humans have had to act in place of gods. Given that it's impossible for one person to represent a god, we have decided and taken our respective roles. I am a juror. He is a prison guard, and you are the Minister of Justice.
I hate it.
This isn't a question of whether or not you like it or not.
I shall never give my approval for this execution.
The prisoner enters. His head has been covered for the execution, and his hands have been bound.
I'm going to start, so please don't leave.
I haven't approved the execution yet.
Even if you don't approve the execution, you already have approved of it. Have you forgotten? You decided in the midst of my monologue. You gave your approval for the execution papers at that time.
This is a complete farce. Withdraw the approval.
I can't.
If, Minister, you'd be so kind as to witness the execution.
I haven't approved this execution.
You're repeating yourself.
We've both come this far together. Please attend the execution.
A scaffold appears.
So, I shall decide who plays what roles. Does anybody object?
Please, do.
No, this won't do.
You're the one who's going to accomplish this deed. You're going to do it.
I'll be the one who puts the rope around his neck. Make sure to hold on to him securely. You are the one who will wait below and catch him. Do you understand?
The prisoner moves to the center while the others move to his sides and take his arms and then climb the stairs. They go to the stool where the guard places the rope around the prisoner's neck.
It's not a very rewarding role, but there's nothing that can be done about it. Nevertheless, even I'll feel better. Well, see you, and sorry about this.
Press the button, please.
Wait a second.
The stool is removed and the man swings wildly.
Catch
the
him.
Minister speaks and simply gazes.
What's wrong? Hurry up and stop him from swinging.
Dad.
The minister stops the body from swinging, almost hugging him.
It's over. You can let go now. Hey, you can stop now. Let go of the body.
The juror draws near and separates the minister from the body.
I shall wait like this for approximately 20 minutes until his heart has come to a complete stop.
The three men finally take the body down from the scaffold. A man enters from the rear. He confirms that the prisoner's heart has stopped. He bows deeply and drags the prisoner's body off stage.
Did he die?
He confirmed his death, didn't he?
What I mean to say is that he's not really dead, is he?
Not sure.
What do you mean you're not sure?
I'm not all that bothered if someone should die here. I've been prepared for this.
So you've been prepared for this as well?
I don't know.
If this is the case, if this is how it is, then the method by which he was killed is how I want to kill him.
Let's have a drink. Normally there's a gathering recognizing people's services after the execution, and everybody drinks.
The three men sit at a table in the bar.
Everybody's fine with beer, I hope?
Yes.
Three bottles of beer.
I think two are plenty, no?
One is enough. I have to leave.
In that case, one bottle. What do you want to eat?
Anything is fine.
Should I order what we always have?
Please.
Three of the regular.
I don't need anything.
Neither do I.
Just one of the regular.
All men raise their glasses. The three of them drain their glasses as they top off each other's glass.
Well, he certainly appreciated a good drink.
It appears he was indeed. I, however, drink too much on a daily basis.
You shouldn't drink so much. It's bad for you. Whatever the case may be, you should never drink too much. And with that, I shall excuse myself.
See you, then.
I'll see you at the reunion.
The minister exits. The other two men continue drinking.
I think I'll have some sake.
Me too. Two sake. Do you mind if it's room temperature?
Not at all.
Room temperature, please. It started to rain.
It has. That was sudden. And it's raining heavily.
Do you think the minister will be all right? He's not going to get soaked in this?
He'll be fine.
I asked for room temperature, and what did they do but bring chilled? Seems like all serving staff is like this now.
I wonder if he's all right.
Excuse me. This is not room temperature.
Excuse me, but I think I'll go home after a while.
You are?
I now understand.
What do you understand?
Your job.
I wish you wouldn't look at me with such a pitying expression.
I didn't mean to, but it is something humans have decided, and it's something somebody has to do.
If you're not going to drink, please go.
The juror exits. Scene 7. The guard remains alone on stage.
I was a failure, after all. When the decision for the day of the execution was made, he was the one that informed me that the orders for the execution had been issued. It's been decided, hasn't it? That day, he spoke to me quietly. And because I didn't want to lie to him, I remained silent. With my silence, it seemed as if he had gradually convinced himself the inevitable end was near. He spoke. There were so many people that I had made victims in my attempts to give my life some sense of direction. Show me the idiot that commits a crime because he seeks salvation. I wander on a much more complex and painful path. Nevertheless, there is a self that resists the interpretation of the crimes I have committed as trivial. This is what it is. People such as myself should vanish from this world. The only thing I want from you is that you remember there was somebody who has lived in this life. That night a voice rang through the hallways as it screamed. The owner of the screaming voice was he. Are you frightened? I spoke this to his hunched back as he was cowering in the corner. I could hear him weeping. After a while, he turned towards me. He had recovered and was completely calm. I have made my resolution. I won't express anything in the way of regret or remorse. I shall seek atonement, not remorse. I see. You should go to bed. I left him pretending to be equally calm, but internally I was shuddering from a strange terror. My entire body was covered in goosebumps, and I was drenched in perspiration. I then determined to make my own resolution. Any attempt at understanding this man was fundamentally impossible. This was not resignation on my part, it was a conclusion. I could only wonder why I had become so interested with this man. It's not as if the home environment in which we were raised was in any way similar, or that there was any semblance in the type of trauma that we had both experienced. I can only think that it was something to do with human affinity or compatibility. I ended up feeling that what attracted me and held my attention to him was his utter inability to understand. I somehow sympathized or empathized with his inability to understand. It rained heavily the entire day of my special leave after the execution. It was a torrential August rain. As always, I went to the park and reported to the tree. I don't understand myself. How can you expect me to understand somebody else? I fell silent in the face of the tree's question. Nevertheless, you grasped his inability to understand. Don't attempt a facile answer. I should confess, the tree says nothing. These answers are always those that I provide for myself. I was able to meet M. His condition had improved and he had been moved from the closed ward to the open ward. I apologized to M, who had put on some weight and had a peaceful expression on his face. Because of my mistake, I caused you to suffer. M responded to me with this. It wasn't anybody's fault. It was nobody's fault. There is somebody who has to be responsible for the unexpected. I was the one who happened to be there. With this, I finally felt at peace. The following day, I went to visit a hot spring on my own. It was a remote and rustic place that I had wanted to visit for some time. I soaked in the hot waters and relished in the excessive evening meals. I thought about my own future. The next year, I will probably transfer from working at the detention house to working at the prison. I would like to rent a house and have a dog.
When I heard the news of the execution, I felt a clean sense of closure within. The fog that had clouded my vision cleared. It was a series of days that, whenever I attempted to rely upon, whatever I clung to, everything around me slipped through my fingers, and the only thing that I felt real was the heavy atmosphere of the last 2 years. This world without focus was a space in which concrete objects did not seem like concrete objects. And with evening, it felt even more that I was slowly falling into hell. This existence that was myself became heavy. The world that had been unfocused for this existence of me began to clear. This world, of course, was not a wonderful world. It was a cruel and inhumane world in its stupid worthlessness. It was the same world that had hounded S to death. The sensations of despair and dejection repeated continuously. A disappointment that stinks and settles. The most troubling things are those so small and so fine that the eye cannot perceive them. Disappointment the size of a microbe. Dejection the size of plankton, despair the size of an ant. This proved to be impossible for others to understand. Nevertheless, should this despair, should this disappointment, should this hopelessness not be exposed to others, these emotions will never reach fruition. Disappointment craves observers. Unhappiness needs a fellow traveler. Humans in the need can seldom die alone. Even if the decision has been made to do so, at some point the alibi for death is always left behind. The expectation of the deceased is that they can continue to make those who live in this fashion suffer. This relationship somehow resembled capital punishment. Once again, I'm trying to tell you about my colleague, S. S gave a wonderful performance of disappointment. S muttered, "You can never do it, but I'll show you. Look, do it after me. Jump." This muttering wounded me. I heard the news of his execution yesterday. This afternoon, there was the mother of all rainstorms, and it poured with the suddenness of a guerrilla attack. And now, this evening, there has been a break in the weather, and it is clear. Damn. This clear weather is so alive, it is so beautiful that one can imagine this world being a nirvana. I smoke a cigarette for the first time in a long time. I water the flowering plants on the veranda. I leave the house. I have been shut up in the house for so long, and I head towards the station and enter the drinking place. This is what I have decided, so I don't take the antidepressant. "Hey," says the shop owner, "it's been a while since I saw you last." He laughed and said, "A draft, one spring onions and chicken, one liver." The shop is noisy. Everybody around me was talking all at once. They were all making idiotic comments on politics and politicians. They were all making idiotic comments on economic policy and the commentators. They were all making idiotic comments on popular personalities and their latest escapades in the tabloids. They were all making idiotic comment on the latest development in baseball and football. They were all making idiotic comments about their bosses and their subordinates. I thought the mists were again clouding my vision and had put myself on guard, but it was only the smoke from the grills. I laughed at the idiotic habitual overreaction that stemmed from my insecurity. Nevertheless, given that I had no idea of when I would take the leap to the real nirvana, this present self, in the process of being thoroughly kippered by the smoke from the grills, suddenly returned to the present. I returned to this cruel yet beloved and idiotic world. I finally had escaped from my obsession with suicide. This is either due to the memories of S or to the lingering images of him as he left for Nirvana. I have been toppled by the dead and then saved by the dead. I desire to vanish. All I want to do is disappear. I have no wish to die. I want to vanish. Regardless of how I may despise myself, the sole vessel in this world that has given me form as a human being is this. To support the significance of this weight is to live. I drink beer and stuff myself with skewers of spring onions and chicken. I suddenly thought to write a novel. In my 20s, I applied for the Young Author of the Year Award 3 years, but because I was always eliminated in the second screening, I stopped writing. But nevertheless, I'll try again. I have no confidence to live, but now the presentiment of nirvana is encouraging me to live. Please, don't make any efforts on my part.
The minister enters.
Winner takes nothing. This phrase is correct. But with somebody such as myself who has won and lost any number of times, I no longer understand why this is correct. Winner takes nothing. The meaning of this expression is that the winner has acquired everything. Even praise is unnecessary. Is this really true? When thinking about the sense of defeat in those who have lost and the insecurity of those who have won, I can only wonder who suffers more. Let me explain. Victors are isolated. They are alone. To win means solitude. After that brief moment of joy, the victor is beset by doubt. This doubt stemming from the self-imposed pressure of having to continue to win from then on. Compared with the loser's psychological state of recouping their strength for the next attempt, this is extremely unhealthy. I have experienced both winning and losing any number of times. Winning is fantastic, and losing is beautiful. Isn't this a good expression? I have kept my balance by occasionally using this in speeches and by occasionally whispering this to myself. I have pretended to be unaware of the damage. What damage, you ask? The damage occurred with winning. And the damage incurred with losing. Damn! So there was damage with winning and losing. After the execution, I was criticized from all sides. Everybody wanted to know the meaning of my former anti-death sentence stance. I emphasize that I had been present at the execution and that my having been there was the reason for the research group. But most people didn't buy this. Even I thought this was a lame excuse as I gave it. Oh well, it's done with. This is the sort of thing that sometimes happens if you're a politician. Something this trivial can't be called damage. The problem was that day, a day I don't want to remember. I called a research committee, a panel of experts, and I, as the anti-death sentence diet member, visited a torture museum located at a university in the youth book district. We toured the museum for about 40 minutes and then headed towards a restaurant on the campus that had a famous view. The university had invited us, and the table had been set with wine and meat dishes. It was a very enjoyable meal, but the panel of experts and their conversation was deadly dull. This, however, was something I had expected. Most of the cultured people, or whomever these people are, that the minister designates to participate in panels and then show up, tend to be extremely dull yes men. Mm-hmm. The meal ended after about 2 hours, and as there was more than enough time until the meeting with the local supporters, we moved to another place for drinks. I think it was either beer or wine. I don't remember. I think I may have taken the medication I carry with me for headaches, wine, but I was carried away, caught up in the moment, which is a bad habit my wife often stifles. Yes, I was already high as a kite, as you can plainly see. I am a man that readily becomes cocky and full of myself. I have vague memories of arriving at the meeting place in the car. I don't remember. I can't recall what happened. 3 days later, I became a topic of conversation. It started with a video that had been posted on YouTube. We were in the hired car on the way to the diet building when a secretary thrust an iPad in my face to show me. I was in a YouTube video. And it's unmistakably clear I was at the community center hall. All of the muscles in the face of the man who spoke were relaxed as he swayed from side to side. This man was me. It looked as if I was gassing on about the history of the death sentence. My speech was slurred, and there were times when it was impossible to understand what I was saying. Then this man said, "I'm against the death penalty, but there's time when it simply has to be done. Understand? Please understand, the death sentence isn't all bad, you know. You do know that. There's no point in paying taxes to keep a murderer alive, is there?" Nobody said anything. I had truly fucked up. I resigned from my position as Minister of Justice. The YouTube video will doubtlessly haunt me for the rest of my life. Regardless of whatever I should say after this, all that has to happen is for the YouTube video to be shown afterwards, and the most serious of comments will become a complete joke. I will lose all credibility. Perhaps I should become a stand-up comic. Even that is probably impossible. I don't think I can stand the idea of manipulating myself to that degree. The vanquished are beautiful. Those who have lost are beautiful. Am I now beautiful? This is my tale. The tale of a strong man.
Hey.
What? Oh. It's you. What sort of setting is this?
Think about it yourself.
I see.
What are you suggesting we do?
I'll go pour some whiskey.
All right.
See you then.
The minister begins to walk. The juror watches him for a while and then suddenly blocks his way.
Hey!
What? Don't startle me like that.
Write me another poem. If you don't, I'll really be in trouble. Don't you understand? Do you get what I'm saying? You haven't a clue, do you?
Won't you leave me alone?
Don't die for me.
All right, I know.
Scene 8. After the execution, I announced that I had finally made my decision in front of the family tombstone. The 12-year struggle had come to an end. My normal, unchanging daily life started again the following day. Once I had made my decision, I believed a period of bright, cheerful days would begin. But instead, I feel that this invisible fog has become even thicker. Nothing has ended. For those who have encountered the end as a beginning, the true end will never arrive. There isn't one. Absolutely not. The typhoon has passed and the weather today is clear. It's late summer and large clouds float in the sky. It will soon be autumn. The evening cicadas have started to call, and there is nothing, absolutely nothing.
Are we finished?
Yes, I've finished speaking. What do you think?
I learned a lot from it.
That's because a number of different things happened.
Indeed, a number of different things happened.
For a while, I was very worried about what would happen.
What did you mean by what would happen?
The minister was pretty determined to not approve the execution. And if he shouldn't be executed, well...
You mean there's that sort of development?
It's certainly possible.
What would you have done at the time?
He wouldn't have been executed.
That would have been an intolerable conclusion.
But you tried to have this happen.
I set everything up this way, so there was little that could be done about it. Do all of you then hope he's executed?
You don't?
Of course I do. That's a given.
But it all depends, doesn't it?
What do you mean?
Didn't he just say that there's no possibility, absolutely no possibility of any sort?
I didn't fully understand his comments. If I had heard the announcement of his execution, I might have experienced some relief.
I wasn't in the least bit relieved.
And in your case, you've already been executed, hasn't he?
Yes, but I can assure you that there was nothing.
I wonder, can you summarize everything in the one word, nothing?
Therefore, nothing has ended.
In that case, what would you have as the end?
It won't end until we die.
Well, then what's the point of the death penalty? I don't leave it to other people. I take the act of revenge into my own hands. I think this is the only method that will provide some sense of relief.
In that case, shouldn't you develop things in this direction?
I became the minister and was unable to do anything.
That's not the sort of thing you should say.
You're so full of yourself.
The prisoner enters with the black box.
Well, it appears as if we should do this once again.
Do we start?
Are we going to do it?
Let's begin.
Why are we doing it again?
We have to. It's the only thing we can do.
The five men put their hands into the box and withdraw slips of paper that they then unfold and read.
This time I shall listen to it very carefully. If I'm not happy with it, I shall intervene.
That's against the rules.
In that case, I'll see you later.
He leaves. The four men move to their respective positions. After I retired, I became interested in gardening. It's a bit embarrassing, but this was the first time I was truly aware that each plant had its own individual life. It was the first time in decades that I had touched dirt. Even dirt is alive. I dig in the earth, and when I do so, insects, roots, and all manner of small living creatures make their appearance. There are hundreds of millions of microbes that exist, protected in the life-giving dirt. I'm simply guessing at this number of hundreds of millions. The small garden that I had never even glanced at while I was working transformed into a small universe composed of earth, plants, and microbes. I wanted to confirm each and every one of the hundreds of millions of lives that were living here and record all of this in a notebook. I ordered an illustrated book on plants and another illustrated book on insects at the local bookstore, and wondered how many of these lives I could record before I die. When night falls, the frogs appear. I then also realized for the first time that all of the frogs in front of the house that had been run over by cars and flattened had come from our garden. Most of the flattened frogs were left as they were, after which they soon shriveled and disintegrated without leaving a trace. This always happened in early autumn. It was soon after the bookstore called to inform me that the order had arrived that I first heard about the incident. It was the beginning of a journey where they never tell you the destination. I felt like a Jew loaded onto a train in Nazi Germany. Now, I'm sure there will be a huge amount of criticism for this analogy. It is, of course, overblown, and the wrong analogy to make. The Jews were being shipped to extermination camps. Death was waiting for them. Death is not waiting in ambush for me. Nevertheless, In the days that followed the beginning of the trial, I thought of the extermination camps I had visited on the occasional overseas business trip, as I felt I was visited by the same sense of unease that must have been in the hearts of those people on the trains. It was at the height of summer, a day when the heat of the sun was painful, when we went to visit the extermination camp. When I look back and think of myself at this point, I had no true interest in the extermination camps, but a friend of mine with a deep interest in history invited me to go with him. And so we headed off to see it. In the huge expanse of the grounds, yellowed in the light of the sun, I lost all ability to speak. I did not understand the state of my emotions. It was not sadness or conflict, but a frozen feeling that I could not name. Over the days during which the trial was held, the feeling of that moment, the sensation I experienced in the extermination camp, returned. I could feel it seeping through my entire body. Even when I saw his face in the courtroom, I had no emotional response. All I did was stare at this man with his downcast eyes. I had become an empty vessel bereft of all words. When drinking at the place I frequented, I scolded myself as a useless puppet, a blockhead. At the same time, however, there was part of me that attempted to provide some consolation. Where are the parents who have the proper things to say when their child has reached this state? Who could ever imagine that they would become the parent of a murderer? It was dark when I returned home, and there was a frog on the sidewalk in front of the house. I brought a dustpan and attempted to catch the frog. In its flight to escape the dustpan, the frog was unable to jump atop the stone steps to the house. I suddenly realized that this is what it must be like. Should the frog descend to the bottom of the steps even once, it would never again be able to climb them. Thinking that the frogs would be flattened by cars, I started patrolling the area in front of the house with a torch and a dustpan at night. I saved a number of frogs that way and returned them to the garden. I only went to the courthouse once to hear the trial. A lawyer informed me of the death sentence. The frog patrol extended into the depths of the night and occurred once every hour. There were times when I even continued until dawn. One evening, my wife stopped me as I got up from bed for the frog patrol. She was weeping. I asked her why she was crying. She answered that the season had changed. It was already winter and there were no frogs. Our son would occasionally send letters. After he was condemned to death, it wasn't as if he had changed in any way as our son. He was still the same son. But each time I read the letter in which he apologized to his parents for what he had done, in my heart I would whisper to myself, "What we would give to die instead of you." When I was drunk, I would cry out, "My son, why didn't you kill us? You should have murdered us rather than those strangers. You should have killed us instead of them." Today, when we were informed that our son had been executed, we felt nothing, not even sorrow. It seemed as if everything that could be called an emotion came to a dead stop. It was the same emotion that came into being inside the extermination camp. Emotions and feelings all quietly ceased to function. This is what I felt.
What's this bullshit?
Hey, that's uncalled for.
Do you understand? I'm the same as you. I have also lost a family member to murder.
What sort of tripe is this? This is against the rules.
My apologies. These lines were not part of the rule.
What happened? Are you all right?
Let me do it again. Is this all right?
All right, then.
It's impossible to leave this behind.
Do you want to take a break?
I'm fine.
I'll start then. From everything that could be called an emotion has stopped. There's no question that with the passage of the days, I witnessed the death of my emotions. At some point, I became accustomed to it. Perhaps I was truly hoping for this execution. It was a brutally hot night in August when I'm sorry. I don't know what's wrong with me. I don't longer know what to say. I'll start from the beginning. From these emotions that have stopped. There's no question that I truly... It was a brutally hot night in August. Ugh! I forget. I shall forget the whole damn thing. I don't even know what it means to forget.
He runs off stage.
He's left, you know.
I doubt he'll come back.
Yes. Given his personality, he won't be coming back.
I'll take his role. Is this against the rules?
Actually, I think I should probably
in
do it if
case,
I...
In that case, I'll start.
I think I probably should.
By all means.
It's May. May, when the trees are covered in brilliant green, and a time when those of us who have shouldered nothingness are resurrected. We all share the belief that life has some meaning. In the blue skies, deep despair and a fragile glasswork of hope flutter and swirl, and our entire physical beings are submerged, and we are saved. But we are not saved. We remain without help, and thus we are saved. When we have returned to our room, where we open a window.
We open a window.
Well, if we don't find the window.
Then what does this all mean?
Let's open the window. Unnoticed, a faint light has been dimly shining in the back.
Hey.
The four men turn toward the light. The light gradually grows stronger and envelops the four men.
For John Jesurun to direct and for you for staying. In case you have a dinner reservation or you have to go somewhere, now is a good time to go. If not, we would of course love to have you with us for a discussion with Peter Eckersall, Kawamura, Takeshi Kawamura, and John Jesurun. So, John, Peter, we'd like to and Philip. And Philip, yes, the translator, sorry.
Take about just talk for about 10 minutes, I think, and perhaps we'll just ask a few questions of the artistic theme, and then open it up for questions from the audience. And then, if there's time, I think we'll have a little bit of time for a drink and a bit of food. But before I begin, I'd just like to name the actors and thank them for their work. So, actually, could you read the names of the actors? They're your actors.
Okay. So, Oscar Delfay. Kyle Griffiths, John Hagen, Federico Rodriguez, and Greg Mert.
Yeah, it's a complex text, and it's, I think, a text that sits between being very Japanese and being quite universal, and it's focused on a theme that I think we can all relate to in some respect, whether or not we live in countries with death penalties or not. I think they did a remarkable job for a couple of days' work.
Kawamura, perhaps I could just begin by thank you very much for your play, which I think is, in the work that you've written, a very serious play in comparison. Not that your plays aren't serious, but this is a play that is about very serious themes and addresses some, I think, very contemporary problems around not only politics, but also, I think, this sort of very Rashomon-like approach, this multi-perspectile approach to the experience of a situation like the death penalty, like an execution. I'm wondering how much you based this on some of your understanding of the discussion in Japan around the death penalty, and how much this is something that you see as a wider kind of perhaps a kind of learning play for us all to consider in relation to questions about death and dying and power.
The
death penalty, despite Japan being an advanced, developed country, the death penalty still does exist, and it's indeed a problem.
それともう一つは裁判員制度って言って民間の人が裁判員になるっていう制度が導入されてから普通その人が死刑にすることができるっていう制度なんですね日本のはだから普通の人たちが死刑を宣告することもできるっていうことがこの芝居を書くきっかけにもなりました。
And one of the sort of points that got him started on this play was that with the inclusion of a jury in deciding the death penalty, this was a something that actually was a point that he considered very important in the background of this play.
で、死刑が賛成か反対かっていうと世論の調査によると必ずしも反対が多いわけじゃない。Right,
and with Japanese jurors, you can't always assume that they're going to be uniformly against the death penalty on the jury.
この芝居も死刑反対か賛成かっていうのを訴えてる芝居じゃなくてその死刑の制度に振り回される人たちを変えたと自分では思ってます。But he
was saying that with the death penalty itself in Japan, that one of the things in this play that he found extremely important was sort of the to and fro between those that are...
Can you speak a little louder?
Is it not... Sorry, is it not on? Is it all right?
Okay. Yeah, I think it's loud enough. You know, that's...
Oh, okay.
That is good.
All right. Now let's see where I've lost my place.
The to and fro.
The to and fro between those who are for and those who are against, that this becomes a source of sort of dramatic energy in this play.
He
was also extremely interested in the death penalty itself.
僕自身が裁判所から裁判員裁判になれって通知が来たのね。それがきっかけになって。He
was actually what do you call it in English? He was you're not invited to become a juror, you're told to become one, whatever that would be.
It's called to a jury.
Yeah, he was summoned to jury duty, thank you.
でも結局は、候補にはなったけど、呼ばれなかったんだけども、だから、僕は、若い頃は殺人者の方の視点ばかりで芝居を書いてたんだけど、逆の立場、要するに殺された遺族の方、家族の方の立場で、書きたいなと思ったきっかけになった。
Right, and this being summoned to jury duty, actually, many of the plays that he had written in the past were actually from the viewpoint of the murderer, and that this experience of having been summoned to jury duty is what changed his viewpoint and gave rise to this desire to what illustrates the opposite side. You know, the not the murderer's point of view, but the victims of the crime, if you will.
Uh, John, if I could just turn to you for a minute and ask you a little bit about your work with Kawamura on this play. I know that you've been working for quite a long time on a series of projects together, but this particular play, how did you respond to this play?
I had read it before we rehearsed it with the actors, and I'd seen some of his plays before in Japanese, and had read some other translations of different plays. So it wasn't a complete surprise to me. But I did realize that it's in terms of a lot of other types of American plays, it's rather a longer kind of play where it takes time for ideas to unfold and things. So that was my reaction, was that we were really going to, especially when we were reading with the actors, we were really going to have to, and I could see the actors going through the script and trying to make sense of it. And my thought was, you know, we have to get through the whole thing to actually start to really understand it. So that's really what it was, kind of the process in dealing with it, because there's so many ideas in it. And so in a way, it was interesting to see that happen in the readings. Suddenly the sort of the light to come in, and it got illuminated itself, actually, by itself, which is great. So.
Yeah, thank you. And Philip, you're translated the play. I mean, how do you deal with this very cyclic nature of this extended durational aspect of Japanese theatre, which I think, if you understand Japanese theatre a little bit more, a shift between states and times is not exactly uncommon, and a kind of durational poetic experience is also a part of, I think, the tradition of Japanese theatrical literature and broader literature context. How do you relate to that as a translator?
With this play, the one aspect I found incredibly difficult, the monologues are uniformly dense. They're extremely complex. The bits with the actual to and fro between dialogues, while simple in themselves, so much is conveyed that's not expressed openly. It's implied. And how do you get this across? Extremely difficult. And his language in Japanese, I found it's very edgy. It's sort of prickly and troubling, if that makes any sense. And to somehow get that across in English was also, it was a lot of sort of going back and forth. I don't know how many drafts I went through, but I went through quite a number of them.
Let's take some questions from the audience then, shall we, in about 5 minutes or so. Yeah.
Sorry.
Just use this. We're actually recording this for archival purposes. So.
Well, thank you so much. And I was just wondering, this to me felt like, you know, I was listening to the patriarchy, you know, that has been domination, power, and control. You lie, you live. And I was just wondering if, you know, the matriarchy was putting the patriarchy, just imagining, on trial. If, you know, there's an idea or a thought about where does the matriarchy, you know, fit in? Is there a call in this, in the behind us, for the matriarchy to present itself? Just some idea about that.
この劇はいかにもなく男性の立場からの劇で女性の立場は可能であるかでそのこの劇の中にその位置はありますでしょうか
女性の立場ありますのでしょうか
そう
ないでしょうねいや、男性が語る中の女性しか語れてはないと思いますよ。
Yeah, it's the male voice is more or less what he's saying, and that the matriarchal aspects of this
だからそれをやるとしたらまた全然違う作品になると思います。女の犯罪者であり、女の監視でありということの設定になるから、それはまた全然違う作品になると思います。
He was saying that in order to introduce this into this play, that it would have, he would have to construct a completely new play. You would have a female criminal in order, and it would not be the play.
I guess my question wasn't quite understood that.
But I think we should be, don't have so much time. Oh, I think maybe we have a little reception afterwards. Maybe we have two more questions. I'm sorry.
Yes, we've got, I can't quite see, but there's one there and I think one over there, and probably that will be...
I will. I would like to, if the playwright would address the theme of suicide, which is very subtly woven into this play, and I found that... archetypal, but also very Japanese, and I would like him to discuss that.
The percentage of suicides in Japan is, of course, extremely high.
それと特に特徴的なのはここで芝居でも語られた通り、その電車に飛び込むというね、電車の線路に飛び込むという鉄道自殺が多いです。
And recently, one of the most common forms of suicide is to throw yourself in front of a train, which happened in one of the earlier sections of the play.
だから鉄道がその事故で止まったっていうと、もう必ず人身事故、自殺だなっていうふうに思うんですね。で、また止まっているって言って、それが普通になってしまっている日常がある。
One of the sort of disturbing things about today is the certain blasé attitude towards whenever you hear, okay, there's been an accident, the first assumption everybody makes is that, oh, somebody's gone and committed suicide again.
だから自殺に慣れてしまっている東京に住んでいる人間っていうのが、この劇の、自殺についての、影を落としている、影響しているというふうに思います。
Right, and as somebody who lives in Tokyo where this is a common occurrence, he feels that this is something that has played a role in the construction of the play.
One more question and then we'll break, I think, and have a quick...
Mr. Kawamura, there's a lot of despair, there's Kafka-esque nihilism, but there's great humor. Is the humor your way of telling us there is hope for the human species?
だからまあその改革に飛んでるところはまあ人間には望みがあるのかっていう、その人間には人生にはもうやっぱりもう望みがあるのかっていう意味を通して入れたのかと。
どこか、どこ、
その劇に
最後
ブライアンが飛んでるっていう。
ああ、そうです、そうです、その通りです。
Yes, yes.
それで僕は最後このオープンザウィンドウ、とにかく窓を開こうっていうところにやっぱ希望を託してるっていうところがあります。
Right, and the image of the window at the end of the play is also, his way of conveying a sense of hope for humanity.
Yeah.
Well, thank you. And perhaps hope's a good place to end our discussion.
It's light from the subway car.
the subway
store. Thank Kawamura-san for his wonderful play and for coming from Japan.
A little reception here, and then hopefully you can finish your questions and